It is now my pleasure to introduce you to our keynote speaker, John Trautwein. John is president of the Will to Live Foundation. He is a former Major League Baseball player with the Boston Red Sox and president of Source Support Services in Atlanta. John is a recipient of the Presidential Daily Points of Light Award. Please join me in welcoming John Trautwein.
I appreciate not getting booed for the Red Sox comment. It could have been the Yankees. So it truly is, it's my pleasure to be here tonight. And I came up from Atlanta today. I'm a Chicago boy by heart, but I've lived in Atlanta for a long time with my lovely wife, Susie, and my four children. And 3 years ago, I joined a club, and people now tell me that I'm a member of the saddest club on earth, and that's the club where you lose a loved one to suicide. Next week will be the third year anniversary of the suicide death of my oldest child, my son Will. Will Trautwein was 15 and a freshman in high school when he took his life on a Friday morning. That weekend, we had his funeral, and at the funeral, it was just such a negative feel, and Will was such a positive kid, and I had to do something about it. So I put together a video of his life, because he had such a powerful and positive light. And we're going to show it now, I believe. And I would ask that you listen to the lyrics to this song, because they are very thought-provoking and very apropos for tonight. So take a look at Will.
You must have been in a place so dark you couldn't feel the light, reaching for you through that stormy cloud. Now here we are gathered in our little hometown. This can't be the way you meant to draw a crowd. Oh, that's what I keep asking. Was there anything I could have said or done? Oh, I had no clue you were masking a troubled soul. God only knows what went wrong and why you would leave the stage in the middle of a song. Now in my mind I keep you frozen as a 17-year-old, round and third to score the winning run. You always played with passion, took the stage, you shine just like the sun. Oh, I, that's what I keep asking. Was there anything I could have said or done? Oh, I had no clue you were masking a troubled soul. Yeah. trees are swaying in the early autumn breeze. A golden sun is shining on my face. Through tangled thoughts I hear a mockingbird sing. This old world really ain't that bad a place. Oh, there's no comprehending, and who am I to try to judge what's plain? Oh, but I do have one burning question. Who told you lies? Wasn't worth the fight. Walk away in the middle of a song. Your beautiful song. You're absolutely beautiful song.
So you saw Will. You saw his light. He grew up in a very loving home. My wife and I have a wonderful marriage. I like to tell people that she's nuts about me. I'm nuts about her. A happy home. Being a baseball player and all through my life, I was on teams. My wife was a lacrosse and a field hockey player as well in college. So we had a team approach to our parenting. We were Team Trautwein. We had a fun house. It was full of laughter. And there's not a night that goes by where I don't lay my head on the pillow and wonder how a child of mine could take his own life living in my home. And I'll never understand it. And I'll live with that the rest of my life. He was big, he was strong, he was healthy, he was a good student, he was successful, he was a good athlete, he was a musician, he wrote songs, he was in a band, he was an accomplished guitarist, pianist, drummer. He was a leader of his friends, he was the consultant, he was the counselor, he had an army of pals. And they loved him and he loved them, and it was so much fun to see. And we lost him. And none of us understood why. Why, we kept asking. And you can imagine that weekend. I was so stunned that I thought someone had come into his room and killed him that night. No, not Will. But what did I know? I had never been to an event like this. I had the thought of suicide, that the word suicide was not in my vocabulary, had never been. And our entire community was stunned in North Atlanta. And what I found very quickly, though, was that people had stories. People that I had known very well in my life had stories about suicide. My brother, my friend, my roommate in college, a kid I went to school with, my aunt, my uncle, my neighbor, whatever it might be. Some friends I'd known for a long time. One friend had lost her brother, and I said, I've known you for 10 years, and you never told me this. Oh, we don't talk about it. I said, if your brother would have died of cancer, would you have talked about it? Oh, yeah. I said, something is wrong. Something's wrong here. He had all these friends, and he didn't say anything to anybody, and nobody knew anything. And it was like out of this woodwork, suicide was all of a sudden everywhere. And I started to see the statistics. And teenagers like Will, strong, successful kids were losing that will to live on a rate of 1 every 2 hours in America. I was just stunned by it. And there at the top of my stairs was an empty room, and it was so full of life, and now it was empty, and it was eerie, and my heart raced every time I went past it. No more empty rooms. No more empty rooms. I started to sort of yell it, and I had to do something about it. I had to make people aware that I and my family, my successful, well-to-do family in Atlanta, is the face of suicide in America. It is the face of depression and mental illness in America. It was stunning to me. It was stunning to our community. Nobody talks about it. Well, I'm talking about it. We are talking about it. At the funeral, I had this unbelievable assignment. I had to eulogize my boy. And I stood up there in front of a congregation that was this big, and to the left were all of his friends, and they had their lacrosse jerseys on, and I was almost preaching to them, because Will was all about his friends. He rejoiced in his buddies doing well. When he played baseball, he struck out 4 times, and he was really happy because he was with his buddies. I called my dad. I said, am I doing something wrong? Because he's 0-for-4, and he's really happy. But that's how he was. And as I told this to his friends, I started seeing my friends from Chicago. There's Mark Savard. There's Jimmy Bartel. There, guys that I had met and were teammates and classmates with 30 years ago. Some I hadn't communicated with in 30 years were there for me. And while I was speaking, I knew what I was going to do. I was going to create a foundation that was going to show kids, and I was going to tell this story. The greatest friends that I ever met in my life, the ones that stood up for me in my wedding, the ones that were godparents to my kids, I met when I was Will's age. You guys are sitting next to your groomsmen, maybe your best man, maybe your bridesmaids. Heck, maybe your hubby's in the room, girls. If Will just would have known that, if he would have known the power that he had in his friends. And we said, this foundation is going to do just that. We're going to teach these kids to recognize that the greatest source of hope in their life is in the eyes of the buddy sitting next to him in the dugout and on the sidelines and in the classroom. The youth group, the scouting groups, wherever it might be, the dinner tables, the brothers, the sisters. The true friends, they're the ones that really understand what you kids are going through today. It's not 1980 anymore. I'm going to say something right now. You kids have it harder than your parents did when they were your age. You don't hear that very often, do you? It is a 24/7 world. It is more competitive, it is more ruthless, it is more negative, and it never ends. And it's unlike what I had to go through when I was your age. And I challenge all of us to recognize that and realize that. You get the problems that are existing on the kids in this side of the room are very similar to the problems that exist on the other side of the room. I'm 51 years old. I don't know anything about teenage love. Don't ask me. Let's talk to your friends. They get it. They get you. It's much easier to talk to a friend than it is to talk to an adult. That's a fact. So we decided to push this with the Will to Live Foundation, and we've had so much fun doing it. But we not only want you guys to talk about your issues and your problems, we want you guys to listen. So I started talking to the experts, like the people at SPEA, and say, what do they do? I don't know. I'm just an old baseball player. What do they do when they get that text? What do they do when they hear that comment? They act, is what I was told. A-C-T. You act. You acknowledge they're going to take it. If your friend is in need and he texts you saying, I'm going to take my life, life's not worth living, however they want to phrase it, acknowledge that they're serious about it. When I was 15 years old, if a friend of mine would have said to me, I'm thinking of taking my life, I would have said, would you toughen up? And I would have walked out of the room. But it's not 1978 anymore. It's 19, no, what year is it? And where am I? Is this on? In 2013, it's a different world, gang. And we need to realize that and understand it. Acknowledge that they're serious and then care for them. Show them the good that exists in their lives. Just like my buddies from my high school and my grade school, my college, one of my college roommates, one of college teammates is sitting right there, happens to live in Cleveland. Love you, man. They picked me up during my life's most difficult time that weekend. You guys have the power to show the good and the love that really exists in your friend's life. The grass is always greener. We hear it all the time. It's your job to show your friend how green the grass is in their lives. The good is there. The love is there. Sometimes you need a friend to show it to you. Be that friend. You will feel better doing it as well. Depression is a silent killer. I suffer from depression are four words that my boy never said. Perhaps he was embarrassed, perhaps he was ashamed, perhaps he was afraid. But we heard it already tonight. Depression is an illness. It's a mental illness. It's not a mental crime. It's treatable. It's curable. It's common, and it's okay. I beg of you guys to understand this. When I was playing baseball and my arm hurt, I went and saw a doctor. The brain is an organ. If you have heart, if your heart is having problems, you go see a heart specialist. Lung problems, you go see an internist. Brain issues, they're doctors for that. But society says this. If you have a mental illness, you go up in your room and you close the door and you don't tell anybody. That has to change. I lost my son because of that. Talk about it. It's not always easy to do. Don't fear that conversation. I'm noticing something different about you. I'm noticing a sadness. You don't seem like yourself. However avenue you want to take to have that conversation, I beg of you to take it. Use me for as an example if you have a if you're afraid of that difficult conversation. Say you saw this really nice and extremely good-looking guy speak at the SPEA Into the Light Walk. That was a joke. Are we being filmed? Because my wife's going to see this. Okay. Use me. Use us. I saw this man who lost his son and he's heartbroken. For 3 years, he's been going around talking about it. Do you feel that any of your friends are feeling that way, like Will Trautwein was? If that's a way to break the ice, then please do it. I beg of you to do it. Will would want me to say that. He would want you to do that. So what else can we do? This group that's putting on this event tonight, this SPEA here, is truly phenomenal. I would give everything I've ever owned to have attended something like this just 3 years ago. They are educating us on this. They are taking a lead in it. So what can we do? We can help them. We can obviously help them financially with donations. But we can also help them with our support and by volunteering at events like this. I've been doing this for 3 years now, and this work that I'm doing makes me feel good because I know that Will would want me to do this. It is a huge source of my healing, and there are so many out here tonight that have lost a loved one. And by being here tonight, you are honoring that loved one. Because you're helping spread this awareness that's going to save other children from having that same fate. It'll make you feel better. My boy was a great kid. I miss him. He was all about loving his friends and showing the love of his friends. And that's really what I'm asking you kids to do today by talking about it to your friends. Show them the love. Because there's not a whole lot of it going around in the world today, and you know that. And I'm gonna do a little experiment. I see a bunch of big old football players standing over there. All right, guys, I'm gonna do a little test for you. I want right now, just for the heck of it, in honor of Will and in honor of everybody who's lost somebody tonight, I want you to turn to the buddy next to you and say, I love you, man. They told us how it's done, guys, in honor of all those that we lost. I want every one of you to look the person next to you in the eyes and say, I love you, man. Okay, stop. Hey. Guys, I only asked you to say, all I asked you to do was turn around and say, I love you, man. I didn't ask you to hug each other. I didn't ask you to get all excited. I didn't ask for this huge wave of positive energy to just permeate through this whole facility, but it did. And that is a great thing. And I challenge you kids to do it every day. Drop a love you man on somebody every once in a while. You will feel better. This is a great night because we're giving hope to so many, and we're honoring so many that we've lost that we've loved. Will would be very proud of me tonight. I know that. That helps my own will to live. But he'd be very proud of all of you. And I want to thank the people of the SPEA and all of the sponsors and all of the volunteers for allowing this light to be shined on mental illness and for allowing all of us tonight to walk right back out in the light. I love you, man. Thank you very much.